stands for the call to worship. They come up and stand in our spots and pray at that time to get ready. We have a greeting, a prelude, and then everyone's going to, so yeah, if you're supposed to do the call to worship, we should stand as well and do our spots. As the prelude is ending, I might go ahead and come up. So just again, watch if I start moving, go ahead. Dear God, we just thank you for being here today. Your presence, you are the Lord God. You fight for us every moment of our lives. We just pray that we feel that grace this morning, worshiping you, our hearts and minds, and focus on your love. God, we just pray for this morning, we're going to be okay. Jesus Christ.
Good morning, Hope Church.
Good morning.
It's good to welcome you to worship today, and the fact that you had to swim here or snorkel here just adds to the fact that you're here for a purpose, to worship the Lord and to hear His Word, and together we find strength in our oneness in Christ. Well, today we're going to be looking at celebrating fatherhood, and happy Father's Day to all of you fathers out there. And we're going to see how God has, in His Word, given us a model in a very familiar prayer for seeing what fatherhood should be like in an earthly sense. So let's get ready to worship as we hear a prayer today.
Would you please stand and join me in the call to worship? Come, bless the Lord with me.
For the Lord is like a father to his children.
Compassionate and merciful, filled with endless love.
He forgives our sins and heals the sickness inside us.
He surrounds us with love and mercy and fills our lives with good things.
Let's worship together.
Please remain standing and sing with us.
There is good news for the captive. Good news for the shame. There is good news for the one who walked away. There is good news for the doubter, the one religion failed. For the good Lord has come to seek and save. He's our rescuer, he's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound, oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. He is beauty for the blind man, riches for the poor. He is friendship for the one the world ignores. He is pasture for the weary, rest for those who strive. Yes, the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. Yes, the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. He's our rescuer, he's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound, oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. He's our rescuer, he's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound, oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. Come and be chainless, come and be fearless. Come to the foot of Calvary. There is redemption for every affliction here at the foot of Calvary. Let me hear you, Hope Church. Come and be chainless, come and be fearless. Come to the foot of Calvary. There is redemption for every affliction here at the foot of Calvary. He's our rescuer, he's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound, oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer.
Didn't lift me up so I could look away. It's time to show the world the power of your name. So I kneel to the Father, bow to the Son, submit to the Spirit, made me one. Give everything I have because you gave it first to me. Through your love. And see who I was meant to be through your love, through your love. So I kneel to the Father, bow to the Son, submit to the Spirit who made me one. Give everything I have because you gave it first to me. So I kneel to the Father, bow to the Son, submit to the Spirit who made me one. Give everything I have because you gave it first to me. Through your love, through your love, through your
loving God, we come on this Father's Day reminded that you are the Father of us all. You have been with us from our birth, guiding, nurturing, and sustaining us. You have taught us and brought us to maturity, always concerned for our welfare, constantly seeking the best for us. Whenever we have needed you, you have been there, willing to listen and advise, yet giving us the freedom to make our own choices and find our own way. You have called us to be your family, a people united through your Son, Jesus Christ, and through him, you have revealed your love, a love that reaches out to us day by day, despite our failure to love you in return. Teach us to live as your children, to hear your voice, obey your instruction, and respond to your goodness. Father God, we praise you in the name of Christ. Amen.
And greet somebody close by you and welcome them to worship today.
Good morning.
What's the instructions for our kids? When do they go? If we have any children who'd like to come up with a children's message, you can do that right now. Any children? Well, good morning, good morning. So, anybody know what special day today is?
Father's Day.
That's right. There, we got some more coming. Well, I want to read you a Bible verse that talks a little bit about fathers. It says, "If a son shall ask bread of any that is a father, will he give him a stone?" If you ask your dad for a piece of bread, would he give you a stone instead to eat? Here, have the stone. No, he wouldn't do that. Or if you ask for a fish, will he give you a scorpion, which is like a poisonous bug?
Fish on the boat.
Yeah, the fish is on the boat, and he would give you the fish, wouldn't he, to eat after it's cooked, of course. So the Bible then says, if you then, even though you're evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? In other words, our earthly fathers are really great. They give us a lot of good things, but the Heavenly Father, God, it gives us even more. So we shouldn't be afraid to ask Him for what we need, right? Well, today I want to celebrate our earthly fathers just a little bit. And to do that, we're going to be invested in some bees. Oh, well, not that kind, but as long as he's here, let's see. What kind of things, beginning with B, remind us of fathers? Well, the bee brings just what I was talking about, bread, right? Where does bread come from? Wheat, that's right. And then eventually it makes its way into the grocery store. But how does it get in your cupboards or your refrigerator or wherever you keep your bread? You buy it. And how does that happen? Where's that money come to buy the bread?
The bank.
Okay. Good answer. Very often that's true, but it also comes from what?
Your mom and dad's hard work.
Yeah, they work hard so that you can buy not just bread, but other good things, right? Cereal and fruit and vegetables and all kinds of good stuff. So dads are one of those providers, you know, along with the moms. And that's one of the things we can be thankful for dads about. You know, they're gone a lot, right? Because they're working. They've got a lot of stuff to do so that we can have good food to eat. Okay, what's another thing beginning with B that a bee might bring out to us?
A ball.
A baseball.
I play baseball.
You play baseball? All right. Well, dads are kind of people that like to do things with us, right? And dads sometimes, I remember my dad taking me out in the yard and, you know, starting out by pitching real slow to me, and then, just taught me a lot. In fact, ended up being my little league coach in baseball. So he was a big help to me in appreciating having fun and playing sports. And so dads, you know, often invest their time in doing things like that. So that's another bee. Well, one more bee for us. That is, this is going to be a tough one for this bee. Okay, and that is a?
Bible.
It's a Bible, that's right. And dads have a very unique role in helping us to understand God as our Father by being a good being a good earthly Father. So we have actually two fathers, right? We have an earthly Father and we have a heavenly Father. And the Bible helps us to know God as our Father, the one who loves us and cares for us and protects us, just like our earthly fathers. So let's say a prayer and thank God for our fathers. Dear God, thank you that you are the one who is the source of our understanding of what earthly dads should be like. And Lord, we know they're just human. They make mistakes just like everyone. But we thank you for them. They have blessed us, another B word, Lord, by all the good gifts that they give us. And so we pray that you would guide them, protect them, and help us, Lord, to love them. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Go back to your parents for now, and Angela will tell you when you're going to other places.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Angela Schroeder. I am the Children's and Youth Discipleship Director here at Hope. And we will be having our separate Sunday school today, but we'll be dismissing after the offering. And just as a reminder, if any children have an offering to give to our summer collection that is for World Vision, they can bring it up after the ushers come forward. That way there's not a bunch of traffic. After the ushers come forward, they can bring it up and put it in that basket right in front of the altar. All right, but my main announcement, as everyone should know by this point, is Vacation Bible School is 1 week from today is when we will be setting up. So we do have a list of supplies that we still need. These are some things that we would like to not purchase, but instead just borrow. So if you have something on this list, an unused plunger is very important. Or if you know of a connection to a store that might be able to lend us a heat gun, we would like to borrow these things for the week. If you know or if you own any of these things or know of someone who could lend us these things and need a reminder, you can stop by the VBS table and I printed out these little great things that you can write on and maybe put on your fridge to remind you to bring in those items next Sunday. We also are still in great need of crew leaders for next week. So if you would like to be a crew leader, which I know you would, it's a great time. It's just you and a few children getting to know each other and having fun. Please sign up. Today is the last day to sign up children for VBS, so if you have not registered your children, please do that today online at hopeunitedmethodist.com. There's a link right there on the homepage. And if you have any questions about VBS, you can come talk to me. The last VBS announcement, oh, actually, there's two more. One is our fundraising t-shirts for children are available at the table afterwards. They're $10. CDs of the music, which I think everyone wants, it's great. They're $10 at the table. And if you really like to do the dances, the full DVD is back there as well, and that's $20. So please stop by and see me if you would like any of those items. And if you would like to help with VBS, but you can't be there that week, we are going to do another prep night this Wednesday, focusing on decoration. So we need to trace drafts and cut out things and maybe paint some crepe paper and figure out how to make trees, etc. So and stuff our crew bags. So if you would like to help us, we'll meet 5:00 here Wednesday. And then everyone, I know you're all coming out to the potluck next week, which is going to be great. And then everyone just plan on maybe bringing a change of clothes or staying for a few hours to help us set up. It would be greatly appreciated. If we all stayed, it could get done in 2 hours or less. I know it. So please plan on staying to help after next week. If you have any other questions, come see me. Thanks.
Well, good morning, Hope Church.
Morning.
Happy Father's Day to all the dads out there. Happy Father's Day to all the dads that are home watching on the live stream, or perhaps you're just listening to the live stream as you're finishing up your ark. Get that done. So it's wonderful to see you all here, as it is every week. Just a blessing to be able to get together and worship. And if you're visiting with us for the first time, thanks for coming. And if you would just take a second and fill out, I have a little yellow card in the pew rack in front of you. If you just take a second and fill that out, drop it in the plate, I promise you we won't come see you or knock on your door or call you. Actually, we'd like to just send you a little note. Thank you, thanking you for coming. And that would be it. But as I say, more important than the paperwork, please just join us out in the fellowship hall through those doors and directly to your left after the worship service for a cup of coffee or whatever we have that you would like. We will make sure you get it, and we would love to get to know you a little bit better. But thank you so much for visiting with us today. I really have great news. I have two announcements. That's it. First, we are still looking for a few folks to host a Meet the Pastor coffee event for Pastor Warren when he gets here. Not this following week or the following week. It'll be probably the first week in July, second week in July, as we get to know him and let him get to know us a little bit better. So if you're interested in that, please let me know or let Connie know. And we will make sure that you are signed up, and we'll give you more details at that time. And the last thing, I do want to make sure that I just reiterate what Angela mentioned, the potluck. So make sure you take a look at that. And if you're supposed to bring a dessert, please bring a dessert. If you're supposed to bring a salad, please bring a salad. Pretty simple stuff. So that's all I have, folks. Have a wonderful Sunday. Thank you.
Now's the time we share our joys and concerns. If you have a joy or concern, please raise your hand. The usher will bring a microphone, and please state your name. Are there any joys or concerns?
Hi, Kathy Burke. I just wanted to mention to keep John and Deanna Bradley and their family in your prayers as John faces surgery tomorrow. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Brittany Miller. I have two prayers and one joy, I guess. The first prayer is for my mom, Wendy. She has some different health issues, so just asking for prayers for healing, answers, and sunnier days ahead for her. And then the second one is a prayer and a joy. On Wednesday morning, my younger sister, Kaylee, and her boyfriend, Drew, welcomed their baby boy into the world. So just prayers as they kind of go through this whole new journey together as a family, and prayers that my godson, Wesley, has a thriving, beautiful life.
Are there any others?
My name is Barb Zimmerman, and I would like prayers for the family of Doris Boyer Graham, Niederhaus Graham. She passed away this past weekend, and we're very saddened to lose her.
Judy Miller, I have a joy. It's not only Father's Day, but 46 years ago today, I married Bruce, and it was not quite as rainy, but almost, and it was a whole lot hotter.
If there are no others, let's prepare our hearts for prayers for God's people.
Another couple having a significant wedding anniversary this coming week. You weren't going to get away with that, Buck. Buck and Joyce Newman, 50 years on the 21st. Congratulations. Well done. Oh, yeah. Well, you were my first. I'll never forget you. All right, let's pray. Oh Lord, we have come to praise your name today. We are just humbled by your greatness. We're refortified by your strength. We're amazed at your compassion. We're thankful for your forgiveness. We're blinded by all that you provided. We're impelled, Lord, to do more for others. We're filled with great awe and wonder, comforted in your loving arms. For all that we are and could be comes from watching you provide what your children require. You are the perfect mentor. You guide us down the right road, holding our hands so we don't fall, whispering words we need to hear, while providing moral support. You, Lord, are the ultimate Father. There's none better than you. And on this Father's Day, we thank you for all that you've done for us. And while words alone are not enough, we pray that we can show you in deeds to fill your heart with great pride, not only for one day, but for always. Lord, we thank you for all the fathers present here today, and we ask for your blessing upon each one of them. We lift up to you, Lord, these prayer concerns that have been shared with us today. We pray for John Bradley as he faces his surgery tomorrow. And Lord, we pray that that you will just bring help and healing through this procedure. Lord, we're praying for Brittany's mom, Wendy, and her health concerns, and we lift her up to you, Lord. We also, Lord, pray for the Doris Boyer Graham family on the death of Mrs. Graham, and pray, Lord, that you would just be her help and help to the family as they celebrate her life and as they enable, Lord, that this this event to bring the whole family closer together in Thanksgiving. Lord, we're rejoicing today for Bruce and Judy and for Buck and Joyce in the celebration of their anniversaries. We just thank you, Lord, for both of these couples and their great example of committed, steadfast love for one another. And Lord, we just pray that you would bless them with many more years together. We thank you today, Lord, also for the Vacation Bible School, which is coming soon. And we just pray that you would be with Angela as she leads, be with all the helpers and workers and leaders involved in this event. Lord, what a great opportunity to make an impact on the lives of our children. And so Lord, be in it. In the midst of all the chaos, bring the love of Jesus to the hearts of all these children. And we pray these prayers, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Psalm 65 describes how the earth praises God by offering its abundance. Verse 13 says, "The meadows are covered with flocks, and the valleys are mantled with grain. They shout for joy and sing." We too are to worship God by being abundant and fruitful with our lives, offering up our yields like songs of joyful praise. Let us worship God with our gifts. We invite our ushers to come and gather them. Please pray with me. God of great gifts, we give you these gifts today, knowing that you provide for us and care for us as a loving Father. As we have been abundantly provided for, so we give abundantly to the work that you give us to do, the work of the church, the care of those who are poor, and the building up of the body of Christ. Please bless and accept these gifts for the uses for which you have intended them. In Jesus' name, amen. Children, you may be dismissed to the youth room.
And please remain standing for our hymn. Oops.
You may be seated. The first scripture reading is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through 2. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. Second readings from Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.
Well, to start off our celebration of Father's Day today, we're going to have a couple ushers with some microphones because I have dispersed among you to some of the dads in the congregation a top 10 list, top 10 things you'll never hear a dad say, okay? So who has number 10? Number 10. All right, Steve, right there.
Well, how about that? I'm lost. Looks like we're going to have to stop and ask for directions.
Top 10 things you'll never hear Dad say. Number 9.
You know, Pumpkin, now that you're 13, you'll be ready for unchaperoned dates. Won't that be fun?
All right, and number 8, things you'll never hear a dad say.
You know, I noticed that all your friends have a certain up yours attitude. I really like that.
Things you never hear a dad say. Number 7.
Oh, here's my credit card and the keys of my new car. Go out. Go crazy.
Amen.
And number 6. Things you'll never hear a dad say.
What do you mean you want to play football? Figure skating not good enough for you, son?
And number 5, things you'll never hear a dad say.
Your mother and I are going away for the weekend. You might want to consider throwing a party.
And number 4.
Well, I don't know what's wrong with your car. Probably one of those doohickey thingies that, you know, makes it do something. Just have it towed to the mechanic, and I'll pay whatever it takes.
And you'll never hear that father especially say that. And number 3. Paul, I think to your left. The microphone is coming down.
No son of mine is going to live under this roof without an earring. Now quit your belly aching and let's get to the mall.
And number 2.
What do you want to go and get a job for? I make plenty of money for you to spend.
I would never say that.
Exactly. And the number 1 thing you'll never hear a dad say.
Father's Day. Ah, don't worry about that. It's no big deal.
All right. Thank you all dads, all you dads. Well, the thing is, Father's Day is a big deal. The need for courageous, godly fathers has never been greater. Our culture is reeling from the effects of fathers who are physically or emotionally absent from their families. So the chance to honor those who gave or are giving that role their very best effort, you know, that is a very big deal. Fathers were God's idea and an integral part of God's design for families from the very beginning of humanity, which is described in the early chapters of Genesis. And Jesus deepened the concept of fatherhood for us when he took it to the spiritual realm and began calling God Father. And you'll notice that especially when he prayed. But not only did Jesus call God Father, he taught us to call God Father too. In Matthew 6, he said, "When you pray, say this, Our Father who is in heaven." Some folks, though, thinking of God as a father is a tough thing to do, because for some folks, the word father is hardly a term of endearment. It conjures up images of rejection, anger, absence, or even abuse. The spiritual fallout of fathers who are failing to imitate the loving and nurturing nature of our Heavenly Father is huge, because your kids say, you know, if that's what God is like, I don't want any part of him. Well, Ephesians 5:1, we are told to be imitators of God and earthly fathers. An earthly father has a unique opportunity to point the way to the heavenly Father by creating an image of Father in the hearts of his children that is very a very loving and positive representation of the heavenly Father. So in the prayer that Jesus gave us in Matthew 6:9-13, we have a model for fatherhood based on our heavenly Father's nature. And it's a model for fathers today to imitate. First of all, we see that a father's priority should be God. Verse 9, Jesus starts out his prayer with the familiar words, "Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name." And fathers, I'm not saying that your children need to keep your name hallowed. Instead, the verse reflects the most basic priority you have as a father, and that is for the name of God to be hallowed in your life. And when we say that phrase, hallowed be your name, we're asking God to be set apart and holy in our lives. And that means we don't try to whittle him down to our own size, that we acknowledge that he is one like no one else. It means that we know that he is above all other things. He alone is glorious and infinite and eternal, and righteous, pure, and just. So, fathers, what would your kids say is the most important thing to you? Not what would you say, but what would they say about you? Is the name of God the most hallowed thing in your life? Well, someone once said that truth is caught rather than taught. And you might say that God is the most important thing in your life, but your kids see it all, you know. They see us under the surface of what we show to the public, and they will catch what's really important to us by what we say and the choices we make with our time and money, and by what we talk about most and what gets us the most excited. And that's why Jesus says next in his prayer, why it's so important also. He said, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Well, when Jesus speaks of God's kingdom, he's speaking of God's rule and God's reign over our lives. In other words, God is hallowed in our lives when we are doing when doing his will takes precedence over doing our will. For example, in Romans 12:17, Paul writes, "Never pay back evil to anyone." And in essence, Paul says, listen, don't take matters into your own hands. Let God take care of it. But how few of us men are really willing to do that? There's a pastor by the name of Tim Brown, not our Tim Brown, but a pastor by that name who relates this story. He said, "Some time ago, I was having lunch in McDonald's with my daughter and mother-in-law. We were enjoying a pleasant conversation when a man and his wife and children plopped down on the table nearby. The man was someone who in the past had hurt me. We faked pleasantries, exchanged hellos, but I could just feel my blood boil at the thought of what he had done to me. This person had wounded me badly, and I was surprised about how hurt I felt. Well, my family and I gobbled down our food, and we were on our way out of the restaurant when I overheard my enemy and his wife arguing because neither of them had any money to purchase the food they had just ordered. Well, their three kids were screaming for their Happy Meals. The couple was embarrassed. My first thought was, praise God, there is justice in this world. He deserves every bit of that embarrassment he's feeling, and I'm glad I got to see it. But suddenly God spoke to me through the text I had read that morning. Do not repay evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. God was saying to me, here's your chance, friend, to be set free of the pain you've experienced and to overcome your hurt. I knew I had a choice to either bask in my bitterness or to obey. And somewhat reluctantly, I reached into my wallet. I pulled out a $20 bill and I gave it to this man who had been my enemy. And I said with tears in my eyes, have lunch on me. Now, was God hallowed or set apart as holy in that father's action? Do you suppose that father's decision to make God's will the priority in his life instead of his own will made an impact on his family? You bet it did, and probably on the other family too. The first word that instructs us as fathers is the word priority, a word suggested in Matthew 6:9. The Lord's Prayer also points to a second word, and that's the word provision. A father provides for his children. Jesus said when we pray, we should say, "Give us this day our daily bread." In other words, it's right for us to expect our Heavenly Father to provide for us. That's his job as our Father. And later in Matthew 6, Jesus says, "Don't worry about what you'll eat or drink or wear. Look at the birds of the air. They don't sow. They don't gather food in the barns, and yet their Heavenly Father feeds them. You're worth so much more than they are." Well, this kind of provision is what an earthly father is also called to do for his family. The food doesn't just appear in the refrigerator. The money doesn't just come from the bank, as one of our children shared this morning. It's there because the father and mother work in the home or at the job, and often both. And Paul is straightforward about this. In 1 Timothy 5:8, he writes, "If anyone doesn't provide for his relatives, and especially his immediate family, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever." Well, most dads feel a great responsibility for providing for their family, but you know, one quick word of warning, a lot of men think this mandate provides them permission to bury themselves in their work. The call to provide becomes an obsession so huge that other responsibilities are neglected. So it's important to note that Jesus says, "Give us this day our daily bread." He doesn't ask for prime rib here, does he? He asks for daily bread. There's a tendency among us men to measure our worth and our identity by how much we can provide for our families. And this is exactly what Jesus was confronting when he said, "Don't worry about what you'll eat or drink or wear." As fathers, we have to balance that responsibility to provide with the responsibility to put God first in our lives. Well, the third word concerning fatherhood that our passage suggests is pardon. A father pardons his children. Jesus says, "Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors." As an expression of his love, grace, and mercy, our Heavenly Father is a pardoning father, a forgiving father. God understands that a father can provide all the bread in the world, but if he doesn't provide forgiveness, his children will be emotionally and spiritually malnourished. Of course, for our Heavenly Father, this pardoning didn't come without a great cost. The Father gave his only Son to secure that pardon. Being a father brings lots of blessing, a lot of joy, a lot of laughter and fun, but it also is quite costly. The biggest cost isn't financial, it's emotional. Fathers have to be emotionally invested in their kids because the kids need that affirmation, that encouragement, those expressions of love. And most of all, kids need to be pardoned, to be forgiven. At some point in every father's journey, he's going to have to offer what feels like a very costly pardon. Because after all, our kids are sinners. That's big news to some parents. Our kids are sinners, just like us. Our kids are growing up in a world where it's getting increasingly harder to be a follower of Christ and its followers. We have hopes and dreams for our kids, you know, but sometimes their sin can keep them from realizing those dreams. Well, what do you do when that happens? What do you do when your kid goofs off in high school and it closes the door to career opportunities later on? What do you do when your child's choices result in a teenage pregnancy or being in trouble with the law? What do you do when he or she gives up on a sport or a musical talent in which he or she could excel? Well, you might say you forgive them, but will you hold on to the offense? Will you subtly withhold your love to some degree? Author Shea Serrano had just taken the exit ramp from his home when his car sputtered and died. Trying unsuccessfully to restart the car, he called a tow truck, and the wrecker promptly arrived, deposited his car in the driveway. And then he popped the hood, and he fiddled with some wires and some hoses, you know, having exhausted his less-than-vast auto repair knowledge, he called his father. And his father listened as he explained what happened, and his father simply responded, "I'll come up tomorrow after work." Well, Shea's father lived 215 miles from him. His dad was going to drive up after driving a city bus for 10 hours that day. Well, Shea's father arrived at his doorstep 3 hours after he had turned in his bus at the depot. He said hello, hugged his son, walked out to the driveway, and had a look under the hood. It took about 15 seconds. His father emerged from under the hood, looked at his son, returned his wrench to his toolbox, and walked past Shea to his own vehicle. "What's wrong? Did you not bring the right tools?" Shea asked. "We're done," his dad replied. "Well, what's wrong with it?" "It's out of gas, son." Well, Shea's dad ate with his son and headed home another 250 miles that night. 430 miles round trips after 10 hours of driving a bus. And Serena says his father didn't harass him or berate him that evening over dinner. In fact, he didn't bring it up at all. As a matter of fact, 9 years later, his father has still never mentioned that embarrassing incident again. He refused to shame his son. Well, the key to being able to forgive is understanding how much we ourselves need forgiveness. Fathers who haven't internalized the fact that they've received forgiveness from God and continue to need forgiveness are simply unable to extend forgiveness. So, fathers, let forgiveness overflow in your family. You've done dumb and rebellious stuff too. I mean, by all means, teach responsibility and the reality of suffering the earthly consequences of our decisions, but create a culture of pardon in your home too. We serve a God of second chances. So priority, a father's first priority must be God. Provision, a father must provide for his family. Pardon, a father must create a culture of forgiveness in his family. And our final word is protection. A father protects his children. In our passage, Jesus said that we must come to our Heavenly Father and pray, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." And when we pray this, what exactly do we mean? After all, we know we're going to still experience temptation in this life, and we know that we're all touched by evil. Well, I don't think this part of the prayer is about asking that we never be tempted again. I think this is an emotional plea not to be tempted beyond our capacity to resist. When we pray this, we're saying, "God, I'm weak. You know, please keep me from that temptation that's going to overpower me and cause me to sin. Please don't leave me alone in the face of temptation that will overwhelm me." And that's a prayer that God will answer. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, where God promises to us that no temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. And God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape also, that you may be able to endure it. Well, fathers, in the same manner, your children need you to protect them. And this protection is more than just physical protection. Your children need moral and spiritual protection. They need you to be aware of the dangers and evils that are out there. They need you to be aware of the world in which they live. And they won't always see what is out there the way you see what's out there. For example, your daughter may not see the danger in dating a guy 5 years older than her, but you see the danger. Your 13-year-old might not see the danger of making sports the highest priority of your family, but you see it. Your teenager may not see the danger in listening to music or playing video games that are degrading and violent, but you see it. As fathers, we need to be willing to be unpopular at times in our homes. We need to be willing to say, no, I'm not going to allow you to do that. I'm going to protect you. One of the mistakes a lot of fathers make is to be way too hesitant to say no. They place too high a value on keeping their children happy. Of course, there are some fathers who take that role as protector to the extreme. They see this responsibility as an excuse to control and dominate. Well, there's an article in the Wall Street Journal that contained this expression: people want to be lightly governed by strong governments. And perhaps that's the trick to being a dad. We need to be strong, but we need to govern lightly with gentleness and tenderness. We need to be like that policeman on the corner who is tough enough to take on any neighborhood bully, but gentle enough to hoist a child to his shoulders and help them find their way home. We need fathers with a lot of moral muscle and a lot of restraint. And perhaps our children will want to be lightly governed by strong fathers because that's how God governs. The omnipotent ruler of the universe is also the one who invites us tenderly, come unto me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So there's four words for us to keep in mind today as fathers: priority, provision, pardon, and protection. But it must be said, and I'm speaking now to those who are children of all ages, that every earthly father falls short of this ideal in some shape or manner. You may have had an earthly father who didn't even come close to making God his first priority, or providing for you, or pardoning you, or protecting you. But I want you to know, you have a heavenly Father who wants to be for you what your earthly father wasn't. Priority, provision, pardon, and protection. Strive, fathers, to imitate God as you pursue these things. It's not rocket science, but it's hard work. Maybe the hardest thing you'll ever do. But with God as our Father, any father can do it. And the best thing about this is that when we do these things, even in our imperfection and our flaws and our mistakes and our sins, we can be a reflection to our children of the perfect Heavenly Father. And in the years ahead, they'll be far more able to approach God to say these precious words. And will you pray them together with me? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Lord, may it be so for all of us, as we imitate our Heavenly Father. In your name we pray. Amen.
Friends, would you please stand as we sing our closing song, knowing that we have a Heavenly Father who has made us his priority, providing, pardoning, and protecting us through every storm of life. We can be survivors. For so long I carried the weight of my past, crippled by burdens like stones on my back. I thought I had fallen too far from your grace, but you came and showed me the way. When I was a lost soul searching, you were the ground beneath my feet. When I was a blind man begging, you were the eyes so I could see. When the smoke was rising up, you were the air that I could breathe. You gave me hope, you gave me something to believe. Now I'm alive and born again, rescued from the grip of sin. God, your love came crashing in and pulled me out of the fire. I'm a survivor. Now all I can see are the fields of your grace. Wherever I run, you're leading the way. You shook the shackles off my feet. I found redemption on my knees. You gave me hope, you gave me something to believe. Now I'm alive and born again, rescued from the grip of sin. God, your love came crashing in and pulled me out of the fire. I'm a survivor. Oh, I'm a survivor. God, you're my fighter. You make me a survivor. You're my God, you're my fighter. You make me a survivor. You're my God, you're my fighter, you make me a survivor. Now I'm alive and born again, rescued from the grip of sin. God, your love came crashing in and pulled me out of the fire. I'm a survivor. Take the hands of your neighbors as we sing our benediction. May the Lord, mighty God, bless and keep you forever. Grant you peace, perfect peace, courage.